need to tell them about what the program is.
And then are you doing, was this just about the college retention or?
Anything you want to tell them.
Anything I want to talk about. Oh, wow. Well.
Why kids should go to private college? Why you call them through college?
Yeah, okay. So most started 30 years ago as a mentoring program for middle school girls. It only works with girls. We have six partner middle schools, five in LAUSD, one in Pasadena. So we pick up, we recruit the girls in seventh grade, usually through teacher recommendations. Now is that we bring in and do a presentation to the sixth graders or the seventh graders, and we usually bring with us one of our students who graduated from that middle school. And then from those six middle schools, we follow the girls through at least, sometimes 16 high schools in LAUSD and Pasadena. 3 years ago, they got funding to hire a full-time college counselor, and the first one to hold that job, and still do, thank God. And it basically what I do is that I start working, I track the academic records, the transcripts of the 9th and 10th graders, but I start working with the 11th graders in junior year and specifically starting in January of junior year. I meet with every one of them, get a sense of what their family is, what their issues are, if they want to go out of state, stay in state. We too have traditionally been promoting out-of-state small liberal arts schools for a number of reasons, the most important being that's where the money is. All of our kids are having an EFC, you talked about that, right? Mm-hmm. EFC of zero to maybe tops 3,000, maybe, you know, that kind of thing. And also I just feel that coming from big, large, urban high schools is that these girls will thrive within a smaller environment. And we give them the tools and hopefully the knowledge of how to make the most out of that small environment. On a very basic level, a lot of our students have never had to ask for help before. They're the top of the class. Oh, let me say that. So most doesn't cherry pick in terms of we're not taking the absolute cream of the crop, the ones who are going to get the gates of scholarships or going to be in Questbridge or whatever. We're really looking at the girls in 7th and 8th grade that we feel have the potential to really benefit from us. Now, they do have to keep a certain GPA in order to stay in the program. It depends, it's like a 3.0, 2.5. And we do get the rock stars. I have a girl who's just finished her freshman year at Penn. One just graduated from Brown and Barnard and places like that. So it's not that we don't, it's just that mostly it's the girls who are in the top of their class, they're the ones that their friends have come to for help. They've never known how to go and ask for help. The concept of office hours is like foreign to them. They think that only the stupid people do or the really, really smart who get to sit down and just chat with their professor. So we try to, or I try to, really go over those kinds of skills that we're doing. Most the programming for middle school is tied with a teacher liaison at each middle school who will work with them either through a study period or after school. We then have group mentoring in the middle school. So there's groups of 5 to 6 or more mentors who will take that cohort of 7th and 8th graders and meet with them either once a month after school. We're asking them to take them to at least 4 cultural events during the year. to, you know, they may not have grown up with books in their house. They may not have gone to a museum. A girl just came who's a junior, a rising senior, to visit us in our brand new offices downtown, which happened to be in the 35th floor of the gas tower, and she had never been in a building that high. And so all of a sudden I found myself, I was wanting to make sure that she wasn't going to faint or do whatever. But it's just those normal, not normal, but those everyday experience that we may assume that some of our college-going kids are having, these kids don't have. So that's where the mentors are really coming in and talking to them about and making sure in middle school that they develop this college-going identity, that they can and should be going to college. In high school, we're really talking about you know, getting ready for college. What does it take? What are the academics and things of that sort? Most, we have monthly workshops at USC. They're from 8 until through lunch till 1 or 2. They have been organized around a theme. If it's self-assurance, if it's time management, if it's, you know, failing is an asset, we're just now coming up with our programming for the coming year. And so that's on a monthly basis. In the college program, which began with the high school graduating class of 2009, all, you know, we had these girls going off to college, and we needed to develop a program that would support them while they are in college. Most of that programming happens either during the summer or on college breaks. We do a lot on resume building and writing, interview skills. We had a workshop last Saturday on networking. The Saturday before that, it was on internships and grad school. We do social events for the girls who are here in locally who are going to school. We'll have a happy hour at some point during and bring people in and really teaching them about the strengths of and importance of networking and how you go from A to B to C to D and things of that sort. During college, we are we touch base with the students at least once a month. Either a mentor does, somebody on staff does, another group of volunteers will do that to make sure everything is okay. When I send them off, I say, guaranteed you're calling in October and you're going to be crying, and let's figure out what you're going to say and what your parents are going to say. And I just had a meeting last, which actually I just like absolutely just stole it from one voice, but it was a graduated senior family meeting dinner in which you put the parents in one room and the students in the room were, and they answer the same set of questions. What are you excited about next year? What are you scared about? What do you think is going to happen to your room? What are your parents going to do with you? You know, things of that. What are you going to do when you cry? You know, what do you think your parents are going to say when you call home crying? And it just opened up this whole kind of one that they realized that they were all had the same hopes and exactly the same concerns, and were going to react to those concerns the same. And when there was a difference, they, you know, felt it, saw that as a point to go back and talk about it. But it overwhelmingly, both the parents and the students just kind of, it felt like, oh, I can handle this, I can do this. I had a parent and her daughter come in. Her daughter just finished her first year and was in school in Pennsylvania, so it was far away, and all, you know, what that means and how to do that, you know, to have to handle those kinds of issues. In terms of actually boots on the ground support, a couple of years ago, two of my students who were at a small college in Pennsylvania called Lycoming, and we're actually a partner school with them, which means that if they accept one of our students and the students accept to go there, that they have, it's not 100%, it's 99% of everything taken care of. And this particular college is has partners with KIPP down in Texas, another program, I can't remember, in Chicago, a number of other nonprofits do this. And the president is like a jewel, and he's really committed to making Lycoming accessible to a lot of kids. Any case, so we sent our two first girls off freshman year, and when I called them in October, whenever it was, and they said, well, it's all fine, but we're not staying, and we want to come home in January. And I said, well, you know, that's a waste of money. I don't think you really want to do that. Well, then we'll be transferring now, sophomore year. And I said, well, that's also going to be a waste of money because a lot of the schools don't take transfer until you've got 2 years and all this stuff. So, well, we'll just go to community college and we'll figure it out. And they were two very close friends here and everything. So then they're up in Lycoming, which is north of Harrisburg. At the same time, two of their very good friends were freshmen down at Franklin and Marshall and were thriving and wonderful and all this, they were doing great. And we put those two and Franklin Marshall on a bus, sent them up to Lycoming, and they spent the weekend with the other two girls and kind of calmed them down and got them all set. And they're now going in their junior year, having last year been two of the founding members of a multicultural sorority on Lycoming campus. So that's the other thing that we really encourage them, is to try to get involved in anything. I mean, even if it's a knitting club or a political activist club or anything, it can be a wide range of things. What I look for too when I go around to the schools is I'm really looking at the kind of support systems that are already in place. You know, that how do they, you know, what, you know, is there a pre-orientation? Is there, this is all for first generation kids. Is there a pre-orientation period? Is there a house that is set aside for low-income, first-generation minority students? You know, is there some sort of buddy system? There's a lot of colleges that some of the fellowships that they grant, or some of the grants that they'll give the kids, come along with an upperclassman mentor. The other thing that's, I think, that you all should know is that MOST is one of, I think it's now up to 90 colleges, amazing college access programs in LA County that are members of the network called SoCalCAN, Southern California College Access Network. And one of their programs is called Level Up. And what they do is that they get recommendations from their member organizations for freshmen who would need or want to be part of Level Up as freshmen. And then they also want recommendations for upperclassmen who would be ambassadors and mentors for them. And that's for anybody. So it becomes kind of a Southern California posse. That they, you know, it's all these different organizations, but their common denominator is that they are, they have been part of a program in the in SoCalCAN and things like that. So that becomes a really strong point of support, the peer support. Another very strong support, and a lot of times, more and more, and I think you probably know more than it, but more and more, the schools are identifying their first-generation professors. And a number of schools will have signs out saying, I'm first-gen. And then that becomes a comfort zone and a motivation for our girls or for any student to see, oh my God, you've got a PhD in anthropology and you're first in your family to go, and where did you go and how did you do it and what was the first month like and what did you do when you ran out of money and that kind of stuff. So that becomes a really powerful thing that colleges can start to do with them. Part of our program, we also, for the rising seniors, we take them up to Ohio and put them through a ropes challenge course. I somehow always have, you know, something wrong with my feet. I can't participate, but I take the pictures. And the mentors are invited to come as well. We are changing our mentoring program slightly because we found it hard to find one-on-one mentors in high school. So for 9th and 10th grade, we're continuing this concept of a group mentoring program based around their middle school, just as a point of, because they still live around their middle school so they can meet. It's not that the high schoolers are meeting with the middle schoolers, it's just becomes a logistical way to organize it. And then hopefully get more one-on-one mentors to come in. I do a boot camp, a week-long boot camp. It's 15 hours going over basic stuff about the college, different colleges that are there, the different kinds of college applications, the different admission programs. And then we start working on, I do at the beginning of, starting on Monday in August when the UC and the Cal State is online. And so that my goal is to get everybody to get all the personal and academic information into the applications before school starts. And by the end of the week, they should have at least one, if not two drafts of some of their writing. Requirements for the private schools and the UC schools. We go over financial aid and this hard to pin down term cost of attendance, because what's really important, two things about cost of attendance is you really need to instruct or help your kids find out what the schools are including in their cost of attendance. Some schools may include tuition and room and board, and that's it. The cost of attendance is tuition and room and board, books, transportation, fees, and what everybody seems to not put in, health insurance. And every school requires that their students have health insurance. So when you're talking about the small private schools out of state, and you're talking about low-income first-generation students who are on Medi-Cal, that insurance does not translate to Pennsylvania. So the families have to deal with that, or negotiate the school covering their cost for their own health insurance, which can be anywhere between $1,500 to $2,500 a year. But nobody talks about that, and it's just key to do that. So also about money, what we try to do is that we try to set a ceiling on their loan debt to about $22,000 to $25,000. That is $5,500 a year, which are the subsidized and unsubsidized federal loans. We don't want them to take out personal loans, parent plus loans, anything of that sort. We just assume have them not take out any loans, but the reality is that all the financial aid packages that are coming in will be including loans, which means that you should also counsel, my husband says I should say should, but I recommend that you counsel your kids to start. start the scholarship search early to try to make up that difference. Then it doesn't make, and then the other, which I'm sure you've gone over, it is that the reason why the it's going to cost less for them to go to Pennsylvania than to go to UCLA, just because of the reality of the funding for UCs and Cal States, and it could be anywhere between, I don't know what you say, but $5,000 to $10,000 that they have to come up with, if they're not.
Even more at UCLA often.
Yeah, so and that's also another misnomer that you need to talk to the families about, is that all they see is $65,000. Mm-hmm. And in terms of what it's going to cost to go to an out-of-state college. But when they get all their financial aid, if they are, they could be spending, you know, $500. Another little trick, little bit of advice, I don't think anybody's taking me up on it, but with the ninth graders, I tell them, ask them to put $1 away a day, and by the end of the year, it's $365. It's almost a round trip ticket back east. So it's just important for the families to buy it, you know, to understand how to support their kids so that they can do that. And they want them back. The other issue, which I found, although it was not stated this year specifically, is the whole uncertainty of documentation and undocumented is having an effect. We get about sometimes one or two, we have small classes. I mean, my seniors this year are, I think, 25. The junior class is 35, so I mean, it's small. We get one or two of the students themselves who are undocumented, but about 90% of their parents are undocumented. So what happens is that they, and I wouldn't want to either. I don't want to go to New York 5,000 miles away if there's a risk that if I come home, you know, my father and mother aren't there. They've been picked up. So it's a real issue, and the only thing that I am doing now is just trying to do it on a case-by-case basis in counseling them, putting them into the immigration resources that we have, and try to keep track of it. Because what I see happening is, so you have this girl has worked very hard, she's got a 3.8, she's gotten into Franklin and Marshall, and she decides that she can't go because of her parents. You know, her parents are nervous, she's nervous, so she's not going to go. So she's instead, she also got into UC Merced or Santa Cruz or whatever, and that's going to cost $10,000. Well, they don't have the $10,000 to go to UC. So she's not going to go to the UC. She's going to go to the community college. I am a big fan of the community college. I think they've done, especially here in California, they've done a lot in terms of the pathways and making sure that there's articulation and that they want the kids out in 2 years as much as they want to get out in 2 years. So I never put down the community that path to a four-year degree. But if you start getting more and more kids that are going to community college, it's just putting on such pressure on the community college. It's already overbooked and over, you know, it's like this rabbit hole that is very, I don't have an answer. I'm bad, but I don't have an answer of how to best advise a student in that situation.
I don't think anybody knows what to tell them.
So that is it. I am still on the search for difference in my girls' test scores. What I have found in the last 3 years is that those who have tested high, i.e. 550 and above, 600, will get the most out of any test prep program. Those who are below, in terms of 500, 400, are not moving. And it has a lot to do with the foundations that they don't have. I remember 2 years ago when the new SAT came out, and the New York Times had a sample reading passage, and I read the passage, and I said, I know where to look for this answer, but man, in order for them to be ready to take that SAT now, it's got to be at least starting in seventh grade in terms of how you're reading passages, because if it's not happening, it's not part of their toolkit. It just isn't, and it's very distressing and all this stuff. So I'm trying an online thing this year, and we'll see if that works out.
What are you using?
Magooch. And what I hope to do is bring the students, seniors, and or juniors in at least once a month or every 3 weeks into a classroom, and they're all on their typewriters, and they're all doing the online stuff, and they're getting feedback on it. But they can also go to their friends and say, did you understand what they were doing here, maybe? And you know, so do a little peer. I don't know. It's maybe it'll work, maybe it won't. But I'd much rather steer the kids to the test optional. What's really key to that, though, is to make sure that they have saved at least two writing samples from their junior year or senior year, not their ninth or tenth grade. They only accept from junior year or first semester senior year. And it has to be graded or comments have to be on it. There have been a lot of kids that I haven't gotten to, and they've thrown it away, and that becomes a real issue. Or the teachers, I hate to say it, did not hand back the papers, and they don't have any papers. So that happened to me last year. Also, to get the teacher recommendations set up, if they can by the end of their junior year. Teachers, I'm sure, because you don't want to have them coming in November 15th saying, I need it December 1. Or, I'm hoping teachers are keeping a list saying, oh, Nancy came to me in May. I'm going to put her, I'll do hers first, or something. If you're, as counselors, are there counselors? As counselors, you need to help the teacher, the students, make sure that the teachers do the recommendations. I don't think this happens often, and I'm not going to name schools, but I had an instance last year where I was calling the college rep on behalf of one of my girls saying, do you have any questions? I just want to say she's great. No, we can't. We're still missing her teacher recommendations. So I talked to the student goes to the teacher. The teacher says, I submitted the teacher recommendation. And she had it. And I didn't realize that. Now, my incompetency, but I didn't realize that because on the Common App, on the left-hand side, it goes for the student if they checked off academic records, writing, teacher recommendations, and everything. And so I checked everybody's, and I checked her school, their Common App, and everything was checked. What I didn't do was go back into her application to find out if what was being checked was that she had asked the teacher.
Yeah, not whether it's been submitted.
It's not whether the recommendation was in.
In Aviance, you can see whether it's been submitted or not. And everybody in LAUSD is getting Naviance.
So, you know, but it was just like this, you know, it was this horror thing, and there were three private schools that I know she would have done well at that did not consider, could not consider her application because it was incomplete. So, it's just, I know it's a more work. You guys are far more overworked than I am, but it just scared me, and it was something that
Well, Erica did a great presentation on the letters of recommendation. It's just making sure that the teachers do them. But now it's easier to track, isn't it, for you? You can see whether they submitted it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In on Naviance? Mm-hmm.
You
okay.
can see it, because what happens is that they upload it, and there's an additional step where they have to submit it. Sometimes they don't, but you can see what it has been submitted.
Right, so I don't have access to Naviance. It's not, we don't, I don't...
Well, this
exactly.
year every school's going to have it, so you'll be able to log into their account and see it.
Right. So I can, you know, that's something that I want
to
do.
You have to have the counselor role, or it's a role that's given to you by Naviance to be able to see the different.
No, but my students who, like at Pally, you can go in to Naviance when the student's signed, and there's a check that your letters have been submitted. So the students can see it. They can make a screenshot for you to show to you.
But the other thing was is that what some that one of the counselors of the school was saying is that they have feeling that some of the teachers, because they wrote a recommendation for EOP, that they thought that was all that needed to be done. Or something, because...
Well, as you add private colleges to their list, you're going to have to explain to them the difference between an EOP letter and a letter of recommendation. That will be a new addition to what you're going to have to offer at your schools because they're going to be writing more letters.
Yeah.
I shared some brag sheets with them. So.
Right. So, what else?
Anybody have any questions?
Can you share with us a little bit more about what kinds of qualities you look for in your ideal candidates when you see them
in seventh grade?
In seventh grade, mm-hmm. I can't. I'm sorry. I don't recruit. I don't work with the seventh graders.
And when do you recruit them in eighth grade? You know, when do they come to your program?
Seventh grade.
Yeah.
But I don't see or recruit. Sometimes I'll do some
program.
Interviewing for some of the eighth graders going into ninth grade. I was just talking with our executive director. Is that one of the things that I'm increasingly finding, and I have to. Somehow is that our students are becoming a little bit more passive about it, mm-hmm. rather than them coming to me, mm-hmm. Of saying, you know, we're almost spoon feeding all our services, which is driving us crazy. So we've got to kind of make sure that would be one of the things that I would look for is somebody who is going to. You know, really be their own advocate, be their own agent in this whole process. We're there. We've got it all. You know, we're giving it all, you know, have access to a lot of this. Communicating with this age group, I could say it's a challenge. I could also say it's impossible. They will not, do not read their email.
Well, no, which is why I use Remind. Do you use Remind?
Yeah. And
that's the only way I can reach any person under the age of 30.
Right. What you tend to end up doing is on Remind is saying check your email because what you put in that email. Our links and all this information and all this stuff, and they just haven't seen it because. And I said, well, when did you last check your email? Oh, I don't know, last week or something. And it's not so much that we are old-fashioned about this, but you know, the technology right now, when they get into college and when they get into workforce, they're still operating on email, not texting. The college financial aid office is not going to be texting them. The admissions office is not, their professors are not going to be texting them. And so it's just really, really important to get them to check their email at least once a day. Some of that I've handed out are our statistics, and I was able to, the most recent statistic from LAUSD about enrollment in 4 years is from the graduating class of 2015, I think. Anyway, that's all the end. No, 2010, so graduating college in 4 years. The other is our brochure, and the third is just an interesting article that I saw just this morning about, it was a new word for me, which was stop out, which is when they stop going to college each year. Stop out, not drop out, stop out. Continually wanting to increase the capacity, we just want to make sure that we're able to deliver the kind of programming with everybody and stuff. But it could change.
The two middle schools that are in the room are going to be great middle schools to partner with. So. It's a co-ed school, but you take all your classes with one gender.
You know, when I first moved here in Santa Monica Unified, I went to the middle school. I said, this is what we should be doing. We should do it in math and science.
Well, this is what they're doing, though, and so they're very, and they're right in the heart of
Koreatown.
Okay. That would be, I mean, the worst that could happen is that we say no. I mean, and that kind of decision is up to the board and
so if ever, who would be a good person to contact?
Yeah.
When it comes to that?
Yes. I can put you in touch with, I didn't bring her card, but I brought my cards and, you know, you can get
so with Charmaine,
with me,
your school would be a perfect school.
Yeah, and so we have them from 6th grade to 12th grade.
Pardon?
She does the RFK campus.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, it's just capacity. We have a very small staff, and it's just a question of getting. What's really key for the middle school program is the teacher liaisons, because they're the ones who are really keeping in touch with the group.
Those two happen to be teachers.
Huh?
They're teachers at the schools.
Oh, well, there you go. All right. All right. There's one of my. You're at RFK.
I'm at RFK. Yeah.
That one of my son's good friends was responsible for the RFK portrait and all the murals.
Yeah.
RFK. He got all the artists to do it.
But Antonio and I have been talking about, and some of us talking about the need to follow our kids into college to not have our work stop when they graduate. So, and if you look at that statistic, that only 62% of them, of all college graduates, are making it through without a stop out, is profound.
It's totally, and that's first semester is, I mean, the most self-assured, brightest, this gal who's at Penn, she was, when I talked to her, the biggest thing, and I don't know how to teach this or help them, the biggest thing that they confront is the wealth of their students at the college. Mm-hmm. Again, at the small or back east colleges or, you know, Ohio colleges, the money is just they've never seen it. Even if, as she said, I went to Venice High, there's, you know, a rather, you know, kind of mix of stuff, and but the culture and things, she said, is just, and I don't know what to do about that.
I know what Harvard did, because my friend Christine and I wrote, if you're going to open the door, let them in fully. So they now have a resource guide for the college about where, if you need a dress to go to the dance, this is where you can go get a dress to go to the dance. If you want money to go on this, this is where you can get money. It took us forever to get Harvard to realize that it's very hard to be poor around rich people.
Exactly, and it's just a very whole, and she said the other thing was that everybody was very stressed out. She said, you know, it's not California, and you know, the kids, you know.
They get used to it, though.
There's, you know, but anyway, it's that, the money is a big issue, big issue.
In terms of the number of kids that their parents don't understand financial aid, and the kids are literally sending their financial aid under their parents. I had a girl, and that's another thing that there was a kid at Harvard who was paying his parents' rent through his financial aid. So as a result, he was even poorer, because the money that he needed for himself to go to school, he was giving to his parents. And I had a girl here whose mother took her financial aid. So that's another lesson I tell the parents, that the financial aid is not for you, it's for your child. But if they need the living expenses, I don't know, life is complicated. We have to let them go.
Okay, yeah.
This is great. First of all, Joy, thank you so much for coming.
Oh, God.